Imam Waleed Hakeem, in this video, makes a claim that the Quran mentions the Arctic midnight sun, the sun that never sets. On the surface, this sounds quite impressive, but as they say, the devil is in the details. There is no scientific miracle here. There is no amazing prophecy. All we have is an ancient mythological tale that Muslims are trying to make sound miraculous. Let's take a look at his video and see what he says.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is Imam Waleed Hakeem. I'm here in Arctic Norway. We just finished our Taraweeh Salah. The masjid is this way. Yes, and I want to show you the midnight sun. You've heard about the midnight sun before, but I'm actually going to show it to you now, subhanAllah. So this is it right behind me, as you see over here. It's just gonna touch the mountain. It will look like a sunset, but at this time of the year, we don't have a sunset. And something else that will shock you, subhanAllah, is that this is actually west, right? But the sun is not setting in the west here. Actually, it's not setting at all. It's actually in our north. Why? Because this sun keeps going around the sky in circles. It doesn't set. It just keeps going around in circles all day. And if you look behind me as well, let me see if I could see it here. Something else beautiful I want to show you. Yes, here also, here we have a full moon. So we have the midnight sun and we have the full moon, and the midnight sun is still behind me here in the mountain. You could see it, subhanAllah. You know, I'm going to tell you something very impressive, that this midnight sun was mentioned in Suratul Kahf, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the story of Dhul-Qarnayn alayhi salam, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him abilities to travel as far in the earth in the east and as far in the west. And during these travels, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he went and saw some people who Allah did not give any coverings from the sun. لَمْ نَجْعَلْ لَهُمْ قَوْمًا لَمْ نَجْعَلْ لَهُمْ مِنْ دُونِهَا سِتْرًا. Yes, that the people who he arrived, they were under the sun and they don't have any covering from the sun. What does that mean, subhanAllah? At that time when it was revealed, the scholars of tafsir have not seen this phenomena because they haven't traveled to these extreme parts of the world. But here, subhanAllah, we have it over here, the sun. And it just went behind the mountain. I'm going to walk a bit more so it appears again. There you go. You see it again. SubhanAllah. I just have to follow the mountain. So Allah says that there are people on this earth who cannot take covering from the sun, meaning in the sky. And that's true. SubhanAllah. Here, if you're in the Arctic in some places, if I didn't have these mountains, you would see the sun all day, all night. SubhanAllah.
So in summary, the sun doesn't set over there in Norway. It appears to go in circles for much of the year. The midnight sun is mentioned in Surah Kaf. Dhul-Qarnayn traveled east and west, and he saw people who had no shade from the sun. Now, before I get into rebutting this, I want to make a very important point. You can always spin a narrative to make it sound plausible. This is what conspiracy theories do. As seekers of the truth, we have to ask ourselves, what is a more likely or what is a more plausible explanation? Which explanation requires the least amount of assumptions? This is called Occam's razor. If you find yourself making 101 assumptions in order to make a story make sense, ask yourself, why are you doing this when there's a much more simple explanation that makes sense? Dig deep. So here are the main problems. Number one, the ayah doesn't match what he's saying. Number two, there's no evidence that Muhammad or Allah knew about the existence of time zones or the fact that it's actually daylight in one place and nighttime in another place at the same time. Number three, the story of Dhul-Qarnayn matches the Syriac Alexander romance to a T. We will discuss why this is problematic. So let's look at the Quranic verse first of all. Until when he came to the rising of the sun, he found it rising on a people for whom we have not made against it any shield. 1890. Matlias Shams is the term used. The word is only used in the Quran once, and it means the rising place. Now, to make sense of this, we need to understand a little bit of history. Looking back, we know that the 7th century Arabs did not understand cosmology. They did not realize that the sun was larger than the earth or that the earth went around the sun. What's the evidence for this? The evidence for this is if you look at the exegesis, the tafsir of the Quran, from the earliest one to the latest one, we will be able to tell what Muslims at each period in time used to believe. Quran 18:86 says, "Until when he reached the setting of the sun, he found it as if setting in a spring of dark mud." Now, if you look at the tafsir for this ayah, what do we find? The masked Arab has done some excellent research in his video. Does the Quran really say that the sun sets in a muddy spring? Looking at the historical tafsir, what we find is it's not until the 14th tafsir, 350 years after Muhammad's death, we find that science has caught up. Muslim scholars by this point started to reinterpret the verse to say it was as if the sun was setting in a murky pool. They realized the sun cannot go into a muddy spring because it was too big. There's no evidence that Muhammad knew about time zones or the fact that it's daylight in one place and night in another place. What's the evidence for this? It's been multiply narrated in a hadith. Our Lord, the blessed and exalted, descends every night to the lowest heaven. This is recorded in Bukhari, in Muslim, in Ibn Majah, in Abu Dawud. It's narrated tons of times. The problem is, it's always night somewhere in the world. This means that Allah is not descending, but rather hovering around the earth like a GPS satellite, locked into a geosynchronous orbit with the night. If the meaning is metaphorical, why not use language that makes sense? Why not say Allah listens to your dua in the last third of the night? Why say Allah descends, yanzilu in Arabic? So just like the mythological pot of gold that you find at the end of a rainbow, which you can never reach, the ancient people used to think that you can actually reach to the place of sunrise and sunset. They didn't realize that there is no place of sunrise and sunset. It's actually the fact that the earth is rotating, which causes the illusion of the sunset, not that the sun is actually setting. So at this point, it should be quite clear that the Quran is actually just rehashing ancient myths about the place of sunrise and the place of sunset.
And most people now are already asleep because they have work, but Muslims are awake because they just finished their Taraweeh, and soon, inshallah, they are going to have their Sahur. And someone say, how do you fast over here if you don't have sunset or sunrise? What do you do exactly? Now, of course, there are several fatwas, but the Muslims gathered together and they wanted to choose something that unifies them in this region. Alhamdulillah, about 1,200 Muslims. Many of them come from smaller towns around us here in Arctic Norway. So they follow the fatwa that came from Al-Azhar about following Mecca time. So we follow Mecca time. So that's why when we break our fasting, the sun is in front of us, and some of you say it's haram. Well, the sun doesn't set, so what do you want us to do exactly? That's what we follow, and then after this we also follow Taraweeh on Mecca time as well, and Fajr on Mecca time as well, alhamdulillah. It's not going to last like this, because in just a couple of years, in Ramadan, we're going to have a real sunrise and sunset, and then we will have to follow the local time, and it's going to be very long, almost 22 hours, subhanAllah, except people who are sick or old or have a reason not to fast.
Here is another evidence. If Muhammad knew from Allah about the Arctic sun, why is there no hadith explaining how to fast and how to pray in such locations? Why is it that we don't find any sort of Islamic guidance about how to deal with such situations? Why is it that Islamic scholars, many hundreds of years later, have to make up rulings in order to explain to Muslims how to fast and pray in such areas? Do you think Muhammad knew there's going to be people that have to fast 22 hours a day for 30 days in a row? I definitely don't think he knew that. Number 4, Dhul-Qarnayn matches the Syriac Alexander romance. First of all, it's important to note that Dhul-Qarnayn is introduced in the Quran as they ask you about Dhul-Qarnayn in 1883. This means that Dhul-Qarnayn is not a new figure that the Quran is coming up with, but rather he's a character that the people at the time were familiar with, somebody they knew. So who is this Dhul-Qarnayn, the one with horns or power? In 1889, the renowned scholar and philologist Sir Ernest Alfred Wallace Budge translated Alexander's stories from Syriac manuscripts into English. We should be grateful for his work because we are living in a time where we can see that the Quran is shockingly similar to the mythological stories from the same time period. So if you are in denial that Dhul-Qarnayn is Alexander the Great, ask yourself, how do you explain the fact that point after point after point matches the story almost verbatim? You have to find a way to explain away the fact that this entire Alexander the Great mythological story that the people are familiar with at the time ended up in the Quran. How do you explain that? Here's a relevant quote from the Alexander Syriac romance. So the whole camp mounted, and Alexander and his troops went up behind the fetid sea and the bright sea to the place where the sun enters the window of heaven. For the sun is a servant of the Lord, and neither by night nor by day does he cease from his traveling. The place of his rising is over the sea, and the people will dwell there when he is about to rise, flee away and hide themselves in the sea, that they be not burnt by his rays. And he passes through the midst of the heavens to the place where he enters the window of heaven. And wherever he passes, there are terrible mountains, and those who dwell there have caves hollowed out in the rocks. And as soon as they see the sun passing over them, men and birds flee away from him and hide in the caves, for rocks are rent by his blazing heat and fall down. And whether they be men or beasts, as soon as the stones touch them, they are consumed. The History of Alexander the Great, being the Syriac version, page 148. So Dhul-Qarnayn went to the edges of the earth where the sun rises and the sun sets. He did not go north to Norway. He went east and west to the place of sunrise and sunset. People used to believe back then that on the flat earth, the edges of the earth is where you would be able to see the sun setting and the sun rising. Where the sun sets and sunrise, you would have no shade from the sun. Just like the Quran says, and just like it's explained in the Alexander the Great romance. The fact that the Quran copied this ancient tale is a far more harmonious explanation and far more plausible than the one that modern Muslims are trying to come up with now. In conclusion, there is no amazing miracle here. There is no scientific miracle. There is no prophecy. There is nothing amazing whatsoever. There is simply ancient fables being rehashed and retold as if they contain some miraculous new information. I just want to add, I have met Imam Waleed before and I found him to be a well-natured individual. He always used to bring smiles to those around him and he always had interesting facts and tidbits that he used to share with us. Imam Waleed is well-traveled and I respect him very much. I think you will find if you look into it that the Quran is actually not from God, but rather it was written by Muhammad. This is my invitation to you. If you found that I have made an error in any of these points and you would like to post a response to me, I would be happy to see that and to continue this discussion further. This is Abdullah Samir signing out. Wait a second. I need your help. If you can help me by sparing a little bit of money, even if it's a few bucks, you can send me a PayPal donation or you can support me monthly on PayPal or Patreon. I would greatly appreciate it. I would love to do this full time. I would be really happy if I can spend more time on this creative work rather than a 9-to-5 job that I have to spend most of my energy on. Help me to become a full-time YouTuber. I would really love that. We can change the world together. Please check my support page at abdullahsamir.com/support. Thank you. Bye. Brother makes a good point. Subscribe to Abdullah Samir.